Neptune, and Uranus. At first glimpse, the seventh planet from the sun emerges as an unmeasurable globe of green-blue fog. Slip below the icy veil of Uranus, and you find a world apparently without end, because this is a planet made almost wholly of gas. Hydrogen, helium, and a sprinkle of methane that gives the planet its color. It is challenging to explain to people what it feels like, the interior of these gas giant planets, because it is so far from our terrestrial existence. The third largest planet has at least 13 rings, though unlike the broad bands of Saturn, these are thin and dark. No one is sure how they formed, but they could result from collisions within a small army of at least 37 moons. Uranus's has a prominent feature, its crooked tilt. It is the only planet in the solar system to revolve on its side, resembling a colossal bullseye. How did it end up this way? The explanation may surprise you, and Neptune and Uranus influence astronomers because we know so little about these planets. We have hardly ever had one spacecraft visit them, and it was a noticeably short flyby. The most exciting thing about Uranus is that it has wholly tilted over on its side. Its atmosphere shifts radically depending on the period, and it has an interesting thin ring system. Furthermore, these, of course, are some rings. It is an accurate picture of Uranus, and although divided by 1.6 billion miles, one of the world's largest telescopes is watching the planet spring into life. Uranus has been going through a great season that we call equinox. The North Polar part, getting into the sunlight for the first time in 2 decades, is applied to all kinds of dynamic cloud action, none of which was expected or foretold. So it is exciting to get this data and be revising textbooks about the Uranus system. Right now, we have inspired astronomers. For the first time, this far-flung outpost is being viewed in a different light, and when it develops into an image, it is not a moment too soon. That is because for most of us, Uranus is the butt of a big cosmic joke. I'm saying Uranus because I believe people are embarrassed by Uranus. Uranus. Yeah, I pronounce the planet's name Uranus, which is likely closer to the initial intonation of the name of the god after it was designated. If you think Uranus is a funny name for a planet, you may favor its first name, George, observed by William Herschel in 1781. He christens his new find George Cetus after the King of England, George III. The practice of naming planets from ancient mythicist prevails, and planet George is no longer. Furthermore, Uranus would be expected to have remained nothing more than a green-blue blotch at the end of a telescope if it was not for a bright rocket investigator and a little luck. As an intern at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California, Stephen Hogan investigates a journey to the outer planets. He began drawing images of the solar system. He could almost picture a ruler between Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. Furthermore, in that process, he noticed that all the outer planets turned out to be about the exact alignment relative to the Earth in the late 70s. Pluto was not helping, but that is not a worry. Furthermore, many characters said back in the 60s that it would be impracticable for us to ever explore those far-flung planets too far away. This mathematical sleuth work exhibits a rare window where the planets are flawlessly arranged for a visit. An opportunity ever used 176 years for a single spacecraft to fly by all 4 giant planets. That was 1977, and so we designed the Voyager mission to begin on that journey. A complex package of Voyager experiments takes the first close-up look at the enormous Hagenbach. In an exceptional feat of engineering, teams build 2 rockets in just 12 years and drive the existing global network of ground sites to new heights. The external solar system's called outer for a reason. It is a long way away. The rest of the solar system beyond the asteroid area is really where it is at. Thus, that is what the Voyager did. Voyager revealed to us what existed out there. On board, there is even a gold record containing a greeting from Earth should the shuttle encounter any benevolent aliens. Hello from the descendants of planet Earth to launder you anew. To review, all Salados et al. We identified the Voyagers would be the first to reach interstellar space. We felt that this was a publication from Earth that we could instantly send a message continuously from our solar system into orbit about the heart of our galaxy. Launched a few weeks alone in 1977, the twin Voyager spacecraft started on their epic journeys associated as the Grand Tour. It was a first. It was historical. Just being part of the entire mission, being a member of this colossal enterprise, the first time in human history we see these bodies up close, it was a thrill. What would it be like to follow Voyager's tracks, to endure one of the most unbelievable journeys in space exploration? Sending a robot to the ice giants is one element that sending human billions of measures across the expanse of space is entirely different. Getting to the ice giants is tough. Any journey to the external solar system would occur hereabouts on the launch pad. One launch is one of the most dangerous conditions for every mission. You will also need a spacecraft. This is the prospect of space travel. The Orion is a mock-up of the Orion cockpit. Thus, we will launch the vehicle and discuss what it is like to take off and get into space. Rocket to the ice giants blasts off. We have presently lifted off, and we have freed the tower now. And right now, I would be strapped on my back. Nestled in tight in the jeans would build upon me. To me, it felt like someone was resting on your chest. It took me back to staying on the playground and having the bully lying on your chest and beating you up. I mean, that is what it seemed like. You are on your way to Uranus and Neptune, following in the wake of Voyager. It will take us about 8.5 minutes to get into space. You can see we are growing higher in altitude. The sky is getting fainter. What will a 24-year Uranus mission be like? What will you observe? What will you do? Furthermore, how will you regularly endure? Coming up, I am proposing a vacation to Uranus. Time to consider what you are about to get into. 63 times larger than the Earth here, you would be fortunate to mark a single birthday. The planet takes 84 years to make its way around the Sun. Uranus and sister Neptune are recognized as the ice giants because of their icy outer atmospheres, super cooled to minus 355 degrees Fahrenheit. The most essential, most noticeable feature about Uranus is its crazy tilt. However, it was not forever this way. The conventional explanation was that while Uranus was growing, it may have been hit by a more critical chunk of accreting material than average and hit it over on its side. The dilemma is that when you do the math on this, it does not operate. It is challenging to get a comprehensive enough body traveling fast enough to be very convincing at knocking Uranus over on its head. Rather than being hit, it is now thought that Uranus must have been swept off its feet by the gravitational tugs of its enormous neighbors. Uranus has tilted issues in somewhat complex interactions with Saturn, Neptune, and Jupiter. Even in these planets, which have gravitational forces on one another. Furthermore, the forces are more exact than we used to think. Furthermore, its dynamics are not a big hit in the face from a sizable affecting planet. Testable. Assume if Earth were like this, turned on its side. Equatorial jungles would convert to ice, or in summer, the Arctic Circle would dissipate. Furthermore, mature into a steaming tropical paradise. What would be north? What would be south? You could get into exceptionally long, passionate discussions at a bar with astrophysicists about where the North Pole of Uranus is, so don't go there. If turning the Earth creates weather chaos, what is it like on Uranus? Do the clouds rotate on the corresponding axis at its tilt, or abnormally? scientists have many inquiries about the original ice giant. When Voyager journeys to the external solar system in the 1970s, it transmits back astounding images of Jupiter, Saturn, and many of their moons. The wonderful thing regarding the Voyager mission, we saw so various things for the first time, and they moved all so different, so diverse, and distinctive. When the images are coming in, staying there makes you feel that you are the bridge of the Starship Enterprise, because you feel you are there. Those are your sensor protection, and you are getting stories back from these alien worlds that you're getting a look at. Who could ever have complete pictures of Saturn rings? So, what do Voyager's cameras expose of Uranus? The irregular planet, or Uranus, was a real puzzle, so we did not know what to expect in the 1986 era after a decade of moving through space. There are great expectations for the seventh planet from the Sun. From the Earth, it resembled kind of bland and honest. From Voyager, look sort of planned to the pictures of Uranus, where we are a bit frustrating. It is a very bland planet, with very few clouds. Not much was going on at Uranus. These are the first pictures of Uranus obtained from Voyager 2. The planet looks as still as a pond, with no cloud feature at all, and it is silent. We did not detect a whisper from Uranus before the Uranus encounter, unlike Jupiter, whose magnetic field reverberates across the radio streams. At first, Uranus does not give a peep. Part of this was because of the radio origin that was on the opposite side of the planet, where the strong magnetic fields are, and they have directed away from the spacecraft. Then Voyager detects that Uranus's magnetic field is wildly off-kilter. You have one hemisphere with potent magnetic fields, sturdier than the Earth's magnetic field. You have a different hemisphere, the one pointed towards the Sun, with weak magnetic fields. Planetary magnetic fields require the passage of charged particles on Earth. This happens in our molten iron core. So what is pushing Uranus is a magnetic field. There is much more performing on here than meets the eye. Just what rests below Uranus's veil of vapors? To find out means freeing your calendar for the next 24 years and enduring a flight from hell. You have avoided the clutch of Earth's gravity, the first step on your journey to the outer solar system. NASA has been working on its recycling systems. It may not satisfy everyone's taste. We use wastewater streams from a variety of origins. We take hygiene water from our showers, cleaning our hands, brushing our teeth, urine of course, and then we take several processes to make that wastewater clean enough that we can drink it repeatedly. The clean water tastes like the water you would purchase in the grocery store. It is still, so it does not taste as good as the water from your tap because there are no minerals in it. It does not taste like wastewater, like, you know, whatever it came from, so with your thirst quenched, you are on your route. Sit back and relax for the next 10 years. So you have survived the decade-long mission to Uranus. Hopefully, you have not put on excessive many pounds from the 10,000-plus in-flight meals. Time to search your own. From orbit, Uranus gives a few away. Fall below its placid-looking clouds. Furthermore, you find a world that anything but. So let us imagine I was traveling an atmospheric probe sent down into the planet of Uranus. Open your spacecraft window here, and you will immediately feel where the ice giants get their name in the upper atmosphere. Frozen crystals of methane combined with hydrogen helium. We might pass some of these towering anvil vapors that we know are there, and as we stared at those, we would look for the thunderbolt. We would listen for the thunder that follows them. Free-falling here is like descending into a giant green gelato. The deeper you go, the thicker and warmer the atmosphere. Temperatures warm up to thousands of degrees. The leftover of when the planet formed eventually. That stress builds and the gas converts to fluid or a liquid, and there is no natural transition. It is just a continuous increase in pressure and density. Keep falling, and you will soon work to boil in a boundless sea over 2,000 times deeper than the Pacific Ocean. Somewhere down here, a little more than midway to the planet's center, Uranus is irregular. Magnetic field flutters into life. If you could see underneath the dynamo core's exterior, where the field is created, you might see the particles of liquid walking about, and they are usually so conductive that those particles of liquid would move field lines with them. Why the magnetic field is created here and not in the core, no one knows. No person or robot has ever stayed down here. If we could get even far away, we might get to a center, but we are uncertain. Isn't that fascinating? We're not sure if you're in have a core. Down hereabouts, one point is sure. With a planet load of water and gas on your back and in temperatures of greater than 40 to 100 degrees Fahrenheit, no life or android would last long. There would be no possibility of preserving under those circumstances. A probe advancing into the atmosphere would ultimately disappear and become part of its studying environment. Not enthused about the possibility of being smashed and cooked alive by a ball of gas? Don't worry, there is, however, possibly more to see and do. Cruise over the skies of Uranus and take a pic of your 37 moons, most identified after characters from Shakespeare. If I were to take a visitor trip to the Uranus system, everyone would agree to Miranda. Only 290 miles across, Moon Miranda is about as broad as the state of New York. But the geography here is stranger than anything on Earth. It is an exciting sort of jigsaw puzzle moon. It looks like a potter has put it together without spending too much thought on his materials. It has pieces of this and chunks of that that sort of look like they're stuck together. Furthermore, freely, we still do not know Miranda too well. When Voyager first finds Miranda, no one is sure what to do with it. Then when the pictures came back of Miranda, Miranda's initial ideas were shattered by an enormous impact, broke up and came back collectively. Now scientists think the moon may be found in the heart of a cosmic makeover. In the initial stages of a satellite's history, the satellite is changing. The rocky bits fall to the center, and the icy orbits are of lower density and moving outward. Thus, maybe that is what we are witnessing. Miranda was suspended in a state of differentiation. As a result, a part completed lunar development zone with some remarkable sights to attend. Miranda's got some spectacular ice rocks on it that you could sit on top of and look down for 5 or 6 kilometers. I think the Grand Canyon is incredible. On Miranda, these cliffs are at least 3 times higher. If you were to jump from it because of the exceptionally low gravitation of Miranda, it would take minutes to gently fall to the surface with this lovely blue fuzzy ball of Uranus in the backdrop. It might even be picturesque. Moreover, while you're on here, it is troublesome to ignore your Uranus tourist attraction. It is a collection of 13 razor-thin rings, and your anise's mean rings are tightly defined with enough space in separating them, sort of like a set of hula hoops, frequently large hula hoops, flying away from Uranus. No one is entirely sure whereby these rings appear, but they could result from a cosmic demolition derby. The 5 essential satellites of Uranus are in somewhat regular orbits and are enduring. Some of the additional objects, particularly the external satellites of Uranus, scientists have been operating on computer models that show they do frequently collide. Furthermore, if they get too near to Uranus, they could burst apart, and of course, Uranus produces an extraordinarily complex family of rings that we think are broken up satellites for the planet. That has forever been the butt of everyone's joke. So conceivably, it is only just that it holds the last laugh. This is because Uranus is the best view on its rear end. As we were flying out from Uranus, we watched back and gazed at the rings that we call high Phi's Engelhertz equivalent of if you have a dirty windshield and you drive toward the afternoon sun, the dust bits light up. So likewise in the Uranus system, I remember lying there because the picture got down, you know, line by line, and worked out, and just the comfort that, oh my goodness, we did not understand there was something spectacular to see there at Uranus. so take a tremendous last look, as there is nothing added to see for 3 more years, till you reach Neptune. Being cooped up in a tin can is undoubtedly going to play tricks on your mind out in space, separated by such great distances. It would help if you began thinking about the science of space conditions. You're going to be in a tight, confined environment with virtually no privacy. Going out from Uranus is its sister Neptune, another enigmatic ball of freezing gas. Furthermore, out here, there is evidence that the solar system still has a few ridiculous tricks up its sleeve. You can now be managing. On the approach to Neptune, be planned for a surprise attack on each side, because at the end of the solar system, as a remembrance of home, a secondary blue planet. Unlike Uranus, Neptune was instantly beautiful, mainly when we produced color images, because it had a blue-green atmosphere and those white clouds hovering in the climate. So you could not help, at least I could not help, but be recalled of Earth at 30 times the Earth's distance to the Sun, and the star appears not much more than a glimmering point of light. Out here, the days pass swiftly, each 16 hours long, but you will need a packed calendar with around 90,000 days to a Neptunium year. That is 165 Earth years to orbit the Sun. Like its neighbor, Neptune is an enormous ball of hydrogen and helium, and it is the color indulgence of a bit of methane. It is so blue here that some additional chemical compound is at work. Furthermore, we do not know whatever that is yet. It is the irregularity that we are trying to answer by studying Neptune. There is something in the clouds of Neptune that is making its vivid blue color. With our telescopes on the ground and in space, there is less scattering in the environment. There is a more profound methane layer, so even more red is consumed from the atmosphere, making Neptune a blue planet rather than a green planet. Besides, that is not the only secret, and something is driving Neptune's wild winds, the most active in the solar system. Furthermore, why do Neptune's spots disappear nearly as quickly as they arrive? Most important of all, Moon Triton has a mystery that all the experts questioning. So as we were progressing Neptune and getting more widespread and more significant in the TV screens in the Voyager project area, that got us going rapidly. We saw Neptune had some various things that Uranus did not, which was a rough spot in its atmosphere. Voyager saw various spots, one of the most prominent ones we imaginatively called the Great Dark Spot. It was kind of like seeing a blob of ink in whirling water about the size of Earth. The excellent dark spot is an enormous hole, a window to the darker clouds below. So it was a writhing storm that cleared out a hole in the clouds, allowing us to see falling to more profound layers. However, it did not give the impression of being solid. It gave the impression that any movement, it could come apart. Thus, we were not all that shocked when in 5 years, it had vanished. In 1994, when NASA turned Hubble, its encircling telescope, its great dark spot had disappeared towards Neptune. So this planet develops its spots. Leopards do not, but Neptune does. It dramatically transforms its spots on timescales of merely 5 years. That was a shock that Neptune shifts so quickly. It is a different planet. Since then, other sports have come and gone. No one is sure why, but it could have to do with Neptune's wild equatorial winds. Spring into Neptune's atmosphere, and you will surf the most energetic atmospheres in the solar system. Winds howl around the equator at almost twice the speed of sound. This wind tunnel in Los Angeles is hardly a ripple of air than Neptune's wind, because in the outermost planet in the solar system, what forces the weather is that there are two factors. One is the sun. Like the Earth, all the sun is relatively weak. And Neptune and later Neptune have some excess heat, and the heat grows out as hot gas when the planets form. All this matter came crashing together, and that crashing collectively produces heat. Furthermore, some of that energy is still there, embedded down inside Neptune. When the warmth inside Neptune comes out, you get updrafts, forcing the jet currents. The whole body is a dominant weather machine. With no large land mass to stop them, Neptune's jet currents keep going and going. It could imply that the winds on Neptune just accumulated. Instead, they advanced over time to be relatively rapid, even though the power that caused them was fragile. What is under cover of Neptune's ferocious winds? Does the planet that gets its name from the god of the sea live up to its name? Can you cruise on a Neptunian sea? Just around everything about Neptune and its arrangement links to water. One thing most specialists agree on is that Neptune has loads of water. However, precisely what form it takes is less optimistic. Nevertheless, it is something almost everyone has an opinion on. There is much water on the matter, but it is down below, and it is seemingly too humid to be a liquid right now. Down here, it is like dipping in a planet-sized fog room. Gas is compressed into a liquid, not an ocean, but a strange mixture of atmosphere heavily laden with denser and denser fluid materials as the pressure got more powerful. If there were a sea on Neptune there, it would be quite far inside the planet. It would not be on the outer part of the planet, where we may put a shuttle or a boat like here on Earth. The mixture of heat and water is necessary for life to exist. You've got heat, you've got hydrocarbons, you've got water. You could rightly have gained some life form somehow. I presume it will not be exceedingly complex, but who knows? Maybe the real colossal stingrays were floating around deep in the ocean. Not a fan of the dark? Do not worry, like its icy friend, there are loads more sea to do without getting your spacesuit damp. Those engaged in rings got taunted mercilessly as we neared Neptune because it was not apparent Neptune held rings per se. When we got there, Neptune had diffusive rings, complete rings, and these moderately opaque ring arcs. Neptune's rings may not be the most attractive in the solar system, but they are yet worth a picture or two. Neptune's rings are clumpy. Some segments are dazzling and very thin. These particles are very dark. They might be water ice mixed with some organics, or maybe just organic material. They only reflect a few percent of the light that they collect, so very dark, very distinct from Saturn's bright, icy rings. It has occurred that these ganglia comets are kept in line by the gravity of miniature satellites, known as Shepherd moons. This was something I was individually involved in, and trying to learn how the arcs were there. Furthermore, we discovered that they were tied by one moon that Voyager's moons had in the ring section. As a ring scientist, I would be inquisitive about collecting some keepsake ring particles, so I would presumably try and, you know, get a space where the jet ski equivalent, and next go to explore the rings of Neptune. Neptune's comets are one of a kind in the solar system. The real showstopper here is Neptune's moon, Triton. Just going to Neptune means putting your career on hold for 24 years. That is a lot of in-flight movies, but what if you could put your living on ice? Delayed animation has long been a popular topic of science fiction. Like the patients of this cryogenic department in Arizona, this space explorer of the future could well become a space-time traveler. The purpose is to keep them in a position of suspended animation until they can become resuscitated. Inside these canisters are frozen remains of 88 people, all wishing for a second shot at life. The dilemma with cryogenic suspension is that it is not very user-friendly. Die first, but this could all turn for the space Voyager of the future. So you could put them in a position of delayed animation, put them on a spaceship, and months or years later, wake them up at the target so they would not need to be alive, and knowing and to eat and doing all the extra things that you have to do when you are lively. Already, scientists are acting on ways to reduce metabolism. About 2 hours after introducing AMPE, and the rodents now are in a profound hypothermic state. The mice who rarely hibernate are imbued with a nucleotide that hinders thermoregulation. A state of hypothermia is then provoked by lowering their core heat. They are sluggish at first, but ultimately uninjured. I hope to run any of this in a human test somewhere down the path within 10 years. Could this be the fate of space travel if we offer incredible journeys to planets like Neptune? Suspended animation may be the complete solution, but will a trip out here be deserving of the time and the fuss? Well, some planetary scientists deem it could be so if we visited Triton. Well, I cherish the night we flew over Triton. We lingered all night because I believe the flyby occurred early in the morning, and it was just so amazing. Triton is an overly complex moon we experience only in part. The largest of Neptune's 13 known moons, Triton is wrapped in a thin layer of ice, its exterior ripple and feel with traits seen nowhere else. Triton has pits on the portion of its surface, called the cantaloupe region, because it looks a lot like the outside of a cantaloupe. The other impressive thing about Triton is that it has a drastic past. Neptune almost unquestionably caught it. The reason we stayed positive that it was caught is that it is revolving. It is going around Neptune in the opposite direction. Furthermore, hiding in these fuzzy pixels is Triton's unique party trick of all. Voyager's camera catches geysers that blast high into the air. It was observed that streams were coming off the polar cap of Triton, and those things were running some 15 kilometers or 10 miles into the air, and then catching a 90-degree turn as they knocked a standard jet in this fragile environment. We are not sure if the internal heat engine of Triton influences these plumes, or they are powered by the tiny and faraway sun, which might produce some local distillation to make these plumes. These are Triton's icy volcanoes that excrete an inky cocktail into the gleaming exterior. When we see black stuff in the outer solar system, we think organic material. Organic does not mean life or plants alive. Our talk suggests carbon-bearing. These are the construction blocks of life. So we believe that the dark matter may be prebiotic chemistry operating on not life itself, but the ancestor to life. So here, we encounter even our last port of call, Triton, cold, cold body. There is the motion is going on. So you eventually made it to the exterior solar system, following the historical journey of Voyager 2, after 12 years of flying. What do you do on a quick stop before spinning around and going back home? If I were moving to the outer solar system, going to Uranus first, I would want to orbit Uranus a few times to take in the rings because I hold that, you know, rings are one of the countless fascinating sights in the solar system. Then I would go picnicking on Triton, and I would make sure that I bought some hot clothes with me and some binoculars, because resting on Triton and looking at this gorgeous blue Neptune hovering up there would be quite a trip. Furthermore, later, I am sure I would be sit idling for Old Faithful to go off long that was going on to take by staring at the other planets in our solar system. We could hear about planetary arrangements. Furthermore, I hold that Uranus and Neptune have stories to tell us, only to hear their stories. They are the ice giants of the solar system, to fathomless realms, impossibly distant and unimaginably unfriendly. Uranus, the planet with a curious name, but with concealed beauty. And Neptune, a seemingly watery world with a spouting moon. It is extraordinary that humans will attempt out here soon. However, until we do, who knows what other secrets await discovery in the ice? That is the virtue of visiting the solar system. It is full of astonishments. Mercury and Venus, the weirdest planets of all. Everyone likes a holiday in a warm climate. But how about a voyage to two planets that act as hot as hell if you were stepping on the exterior of Mercury? You would need one heck of a spacesuit. Perplexing, Mercury appears inert and abandoned, but buried deep inside is a clue to a complex past. the minor planet created out of the densest material, including the most lunar-like scenery at its surface and producing the magnetic field. It is a planet that is part boiler, part freezer. Finally, you get to the greater ranges on Mercury. The ice is held in places where the sun never more glows. It is nearby Venus, goddess of love, who will soften your heart and break your defenses concurrently. So that is how real how. Once the double of Earth, something ran wrong here, remarkably wrong. At some point, Venus possessed an ocean's worth of water that is presently gone. What changed Venus from heaven to a pressure cooker? I like to practice the term alien Venus. I think Venus is the most different planet we have. Could this be our fate? The Earth's destination looks similar to how Venus seems today, and here on our doorstep, there is perhaps the most incredible survival story of all. Some thought that Venus might still shelter life, even though it is such an unfriendly place. There has never existed a more suitable time to go wherever no human has operated before boldly. To follow in the tracks of our robot explorers, furthermore visit the planetoids of our solar system looks proper for launch into. No man ever desired to be an astronaut. Imagine it was you traveling to the hot zone of the two inner planets. Where would you go? What would you perceive? And how would you endure? The most advanced robotic missions have shared more about these environments than ever previously. Armed with this original knowledge, think of this as your Voyager guide to our related neighbors. Right now, as the planet nearest to the sun, Mercury is the ultimate summer holiday. Step out of your spacecraft and sizzling warmth is assured for a day that lasts 3 months. Furthermore, when the sun ultimately does not set the night, life starts with a bizarre cosmic light display. This is one pockmarked planetoid worth taking a closer look at. Like our moon, Mercury is masked in craters. More and more, you know you cannot stare at the moon or Mercury without viewing impact cavities. What is inspiring for me is that I get to be one of the first people to see these pictures of, you know, places on the planet that we have never observed before. Most people come here to Meteor Crater in Arizona to see a massive hole in the ground. If you want to analyze collision craters on Mercury, this is the best spot to reach. I mean, this is the question well-preserved collision crater on Earth. It is nearest you are going to make it. Question whatever it would be like to catch a scroll on Mercury. You can roam around a meteorite crater in approximately an hour, but on Mercury, you would not comprehend when to finish. Craters here range as far as the eye can see. If you are lying on a crater on Mercury, this crater would be a relatively young one, and you would likewise have craters on top of such one. You would have cavities down. I mean, also simply the little rocks here would have tinier craters on them, and then, you know, you would presumably be inside an immense, colossal crater too, that you would not even be capable of recognizing. All of us are here later to curb over. Although no human has ever set foot on Mercury, we have a fairly good idea of what you would see. We got to get under and go. If you were wandering around on the exterior of Mercury, it would resemble a lot like the, when you walk onto Mercury, you move into a world with no actual atmosphere, where the sky is as black as midnight and burning in the sunshine. Furthermore, a drive is an off-road trek by at least a 3 billion-year-old battlefront. Enormous craters, shallow craters, craters throughout. So that is your initial hypothesis. Mercury caught most of its battering early on, as the moon, a silent observer to the dawn of time. It has been uninterrupted by a single drop of rainfall or puff of wind ever following. Mostly, the exterior of Mercury has been fixed in time for points of billions of years, and you may state that is boring, but unnecessary if it is a good thing because these planets, such as Mercury in the moon, conserve a history of what was going through this critical early phase of the solar system's development. Thus, we can analyze it yonder, because it is lying directly on the exterior. As a result, each rock and pit of this pockmarked world has the potential to stare back 4.5 billion years. Calculating these craters is just the primary challenge to unveiling a similar planet to Mercury. It is constantly low on the boundary, so it is hard to aim a telescope from Earth. Furthermore, it is hard to revolve around Mercury because it is so tight to the Sun. For that purpose, Mercury continues to be one of the most underexplored planets in our solar system. Like its geological past, many characters are an enigma, but some things we do know. This lonely planet has a newfangled sense of keeping time. Once you land, you will reset your watch for a time zone like no other. It has such an eccentric orbit and revolution period, the days and nights are unusual. Mercury in the air is only 88 Earth days long. Thanks to its quick dash around the Sun, it revolves so slowly that a single day takes much longer. The day on Mercury is about a half a year on Earth terms. Although associated with us since classical times, we have a limited idea of what the planet resembled for thousands of years. Then in 1974, NASA's Mariner 10 transfers back into the first ever glimpses of its surface images that can be transferred to tracking stations and onto the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California due to Mercury's crawling revolution and its elliptical orbit around the Sun. When it shuttled by 3 times, it saw the identical half of the planet, so we have only examined something like 45% of the planet at moderately low resolution. Stored in these obscure black and white postcards for above 30 years are signs that feature to one of Mercury's most giant puzzles. It has been contracting. Mercury does not have plate tectonics such as the Earth produces, so we know that Mercury's crust is supporting much concentration. Furthermore, the single way you can achieve that is if the planet track, as Mariner 10 flies past, the mystery intensifies. The spacecraft discovers an enormous iron core hidden inside. Thus, you can consider it as a significantly shriveling planet. Mercury's center makes up about 60% of the planet's biomass. It is nearly twice as large as Earth's. Why would it have such a big core for such a minor planet? Some people hold a tremendous collision. I shredded off a lot of the planetoid, and momentarily, we see the remains of a formerly major giant planet. What is left is a planet's capacity for iron. Many inquiries about Mercury endure unsettled, questions a new mission will conceivably solve. NASA's Messenger shuttle will become the leading probe to orbit Mercury. Getting a spacecraft into orbit around Mercury is doubtful for 2 ends, the Sun and the Sun. The Sun causes heat, and the Sun is a source of gravity. To creep beyond the Sun, Messenger takes a convoluted path, flying past the Earth once, Venus twice, and Mercury itself 3 times, to enter full-time orbit by 2011. If you get into orbit, you can complete mapping the entire planet at sensibly high resolution, so we will begin having a mature and significant knowledge of Mercury not only at the surface, but its physical chemistry throughout the full planet. From that, we can explain to some extent how it developed. What other mysteries are etched into Mercury's aged surface already? Messenger has sent after some curious evidence. Miners more than landing at Mercury, a list of absolute miracles to see, and a dazzling light show. Left on, after runners 3 flybys, we have now outlined over 90% of the planetoid apprehended from around 124 miles. These pictures are the most open to date of Mercury. Furthermore, it is easy to spot a cavity of epic relationships, the effect of still another titanic impact. That is the color space and this contact basin, and it comprises nearly 3 million square kilometers. It is one of the largest in the solar system, the dimensions of Alaska and California connected. whatever produced Chloris nearly wrecked the planet. It was something in the order of 100 kilometers in size. It could have held an enormous comet or an extensive asteroid. Instead, it has a catastrophic influence on the surface. Shockwaves waved around the crust, buckling it onto the opposite side. Furthermore, near the crater's middle is an extra thrilling geological mystery, with experts scratching their heads. The spider is this unusual feature around the center of the Chloris Basin, of a spider that bothers me when I catch people call it because it does not look related to a spider. How many legs does a spider possess? 8, right? It resembles 100-legged spiders, but it possesses these radiating fractures coming out of it. Whether the spider is the effect of planetary stretch marks or some mysterious cratering method, no one understands. It is an exciting feature, and we do not understand what form. It is pretty tantalite. Mercury glistens as a cemetery of past astronomical encounters, but is it as lifeless as it appears? A wise traveler would step with discretion. When we gaze at the surface, there are all these cavities, and they are identical structures. Thus, when we observe a crater that resembles this one here, it does not possess an elevated rim. It has unevenly shaped. That is always impressive, because those are volcanic apertures. Thus, this is the site of sensitive volcanism that's occurred. It was not just, you know, lava streaming out. It was certainly firefighting events, too. We resolved a 30-year-old debate about the geological development of the planet originating from a question that Mariner 10 established but did not solve, and that is how vital volcanism has been on the history of that planet. So for a planet that seems inactive, more has been working on deep inside Mercury than we ever gave it account for. There is even more happening above the surface that cannot be comprehended, and it includes the ruthless force of the Sun. Like Mercury, the Earth takes a thrashing from the Sun's violent ire. Flares, sunstorms, and other solar hissy fits can cause electronic deformation for the satellites that traverse above our heads. Fortunately, the Earth is shielded from this radiation by a magnetic buffer, a kind of force field produced by our molten iron core. Planetary magnetic fields shield planets, their exteriors, and their environments from energized particles that are continuously coming from the Sun. The auroras that illuminate our polar skies are a testimony of our guarding shield at practice. Without it, life would not survive here. Visit Mercury, and you will attend the only different planet in the inner solar system including a magnetic field. Now, the puzzle there is that to hold a magnetic field, you need to have an inside to the planet that is at least somewhat molten Mercury. One of the smallest of the planets would have been required to have chilled all the way through. Its very continuation defies interpretation. The purpose you desire to go to Mercury as a voyage target would be this nice side view, because it will be highly unusual in the solar system. We have a moderately strong, very distinct magnetic field with an origin found deep in the planet. Whatever tool drives Mercury's magnetic field, it is too vulnerable to defend from the Sun's full force, the solar wind, and buffet Mercury's tenuous atmosphere. Furthermore, in the method, it puts on a radiant show. You hold sodium, that is, atoms that are flowing off and delivering this yellow light, so you could essentially look like you are standing in a donut of sodium discharge. With the morning 3 months away, you will have loads of time to sit back and take in the picture framed in a radiance of amber light. You could get a rather excellent light display in some function, and I know people go to Canada to study the Northern Lights all the time. Thus, that would be the motivation to go to Mercury, not a night owl and then travel into daylight. If you require a suntan, you cannot beat the dirty powers of Mercury. Stretch out on the sand here, and the Sun crackles and fishes right over you, emerging almost 3 times more noticeable in the sky and 7 times as warm. If you were strolling on the surface of Mercury, you require one heck of a spacesuit, because if you stayed in the Sun, it would swelter. You would see an immense Sun in the sky that would just, you know, cooked to death if you spent any long terms in it. The mercury rises mercury to a toasty 840 degrees Fahrenheit. That is about twice as warm as your kitchen oven on full power. At such large temperatures, you have a place where you may have ponds of liquid metals, and you would absolutely not want to step in them. You can always head to the dark side to avoid the temperature, but dress cordially with essentially no atmosphere to keep the heat, the temperature plunges to minus 275 degrees. Furthermore, it is here in the freezer that Messenger will face another puzzle. Can ice subsist on a planet so near to the sun? Only during the first radar investigations of the exterior of Mercury were taken back in the 90s was it found that Mercury had what seemed to be polar caps in these initial radar images. Some corners of Mercury's polar cavities are in eternal shadow here on the most sun-baked planet of all. Water appears to survive, frozen in constant darkness. The ice is carried in places where the sun never illuminates. Thus, the ice is collected in these dark depths of craters at the high latitude areas. We found the same information on our moon in late 2020, and the LCROSS mission dropped a probe into a deeply shaded crater, confirming ice buried near the lunar south pole. Where did it come from? A comet? It is captivating because we believe that the water in the Earth and its environment in the oceans is still below the exterior, probably came from a related source. Thus, part of the story of Mercury is to find out whatever the water came from, and perhaps that might help us locate where the water on Earth originated from. It may never more be conceived to send a human to Mercury, but how concerning a robot? In 2021, when Messenger appeared in orbit, imagine this tiny firm spacecraft orbiting a remote planet, a very significant way from home. Move away from the sun, and you would assume things to chill down a fraction. Venus, the image of coolness and quiet, all colorless, beguiling, cloaked by clouds, but the planet of love is shrouded in irregularity. Underneath the clouds are the solitary planet in the solar system to revolve backward, and it appears so very gradually. If you could comprehend it, the sun rises in the west and sets in the east a full day here, lasts for 8 Earth months, which is greater than the Venusian year. Venus, you can stroll around the planet quicker than the planet revolves. The sky overhead is as heavy as it seems, packed with CO2. Venus's cloud covering is primarily made of carbon dioxide from the Earth. We have the same amount, but it has been tied up in rocks like mine. Stones are drawn up in reefs on Venus. All that carbon dioxide is in the atmosphere. It is the difference among worlds that are so interesting. This is because 4.5 billion years ago, Venus and Earth began as terrestrial doubles. They were developed right alongside to each other. They are familiar to each other in the solar system. They have comparable dimensions. Not only this, but we also now understand that the planets were transferring material early on. Bits of Earth were settling on Venus, and bits of Venus were dropping in on Earth. So if living already started on any of these worlds, it might well have developed among them in these small flakes getting hit off from all the collisions happening then, all the other big clashes. You are beyond on the most interesting, nerve-shattering journey in the history of man. 50 years ago, it was easy for us to dream of Venus closer to the sun and shrouded in clouds to be searched our scorched tropic system teeming with life. This image of Venus is a sort of archaic, steamy Earth, complete with enormous tree ferns and dinosaurs. Collectively, it looked to us like it should just be perhaps even populated. In the late 50s, the space race starts while America points to the moon. Settling on Venus proved difficult. One by one, the Soviet Venifera probes pass within the thick Venusian atmosphere. Their last broadcasts were advising of a world of inconceivably high temperatures and pressure. Nevertheless, tenacity, and challenging Russian design ultimately pay off in 1975. The camera on the redesigned Venire and 9 eventually enter the Venetian Veil. What it perceives is nothing similar to the tropical utopia envisioned. This is the first ever picture taken from the surface of a different planet. Furthermore, that is the earliest time it was delivered. Black and white scenes of the dinosaurs. These pictures were necessary because it is the earliest time we human beings got a chance to see. One of the most entertaining things about Venus is that we understand that it had a sentiment like the one we had here on Earth in Venus's history. There have been elements measured in the environment that show you that at some period, Venus possessed an ocean's worth of liquid that is now gone. Atlantis, Houston, everything below here seems reasonable to us. So wherever did all the water on Venus go? And what else rests hidden under her veil? In 1989, the space shuttle Atlantis launched the Magellan probe near Venus. Roger all. After 15 months, Magellan used radiolocation eyes to gaze through the vapors from orbit. When you have that knowledge to pick an image and say, I am one of the initial 3 people, I am one of the initial 5 people to ever look at this section of ground on another planet, it is such a feeling of awe and a sense of innovation. Magellan's radar removes the dense clouds for the first time, and we comprehend all of Venus laid bare. Embrace to Lavalier. There are volcanoes of all measurements, from a kilometer transverse to hundreds of kilometers across. Furthermore, for that reason, it is not all that different from some areas on Earth. Nevertheless, on the other hold, in this barren world with no nature at all, it is the absolute number of volcanoes that begins Venus apart. This is a world that has been wounded by fire. Over 600 enormous volcanoes penetrate its surface. Some may, however, be working. You can recognize from this spheroid of Venus, which compromises the Magellan imagery hung over the globe, and then the tones tell you how high the surfaces are. So the dark blues are low ranges and the lighter colors are higher is one of my preferences is up here in Ishtar Terra, where we possess a continent-sized territory. So think of something sort of on the scale of Africa or Australia. Furthermore, I question if Ishtar, somehow the remains of a past event of plate tectonics, is not early in Venus's history. Just an attempt like this would probably seem a lot like a Mark Bullock likes wasting time on Venus, at least the variant he finds here on Earth. Hawaii has some of the most striking volcanoes, similar to the volcanoes that we observe on Venus. The vast, lightly sloped volcanoes of Hawaii may move on Venus. There are at least 150 extending from this size to 10 times greater. The discerning visitor may remark that Venus is craving something. The whole impact crater position on Venus is very perplexing. With the Magellan pictures, we see a tiny amount of impact craters. Furthermore, wherein 1,000 is such a minute number because we understand how impactors become in. We can date the exterior to somewhere along 300 million and 1 billion years old. Someday in the modern geological past, it appears the entire surface of Venus was changed and swiftly. The surface geology of Venus is separate from the Earth, basically because of the shortage of water. Water is not lubricating that covering, so you do not get plate tectonics, rather. What shows to follow is that forces inside the planetoid attempt to move things around, but they cannot. It has bolted, and then it erupts. Pervasive, globally explosive events happen about every 0.5 billion to 2 billion years. So you would not require to be on Venus when that occurs because once something opens the way, the entire planet might erupt and set itself over in a short amount of time in geological cycles. So this is an example of the big secrets of Venus and something that we need to find out. In recent years, obtaining the source of Venus is thick. The atmosphere has grown crucial for all of us down here on Earth. 0.5 million tons of sulfur dioxide blew into the atmosphere each year. No one on Earth would like our world to stink. Like Venus, we favor oxygen to acid and poison. You can detect the sulfur probably when Venus would smell like we could fly over it, and we absolutely would not like to breathe in an enormous pressure cooker set on high. You would not aspire to live on Venus, period. Venus is what you get when the greenhouse influence goes wrong. The entire greenhouse effect was not identified as a significant effect to control planetary climates until we traveled to Venus and determined that instead of being 90 degrees Fahrenheit, it was 900 degrees Fahrenheit. Furthermore, we said, wait, what is wrong with this is gained about this. Furthermore, it showed us about the greenhouse on the greenhouse. Ever questioned how alien a planet could be? How bad a weather can get? Try the planet next door. The best way to encounter satisfaction is to hitch a fabulous ride on a Soviet veneer method. Well, it would be a wild ride. The clouds rise up about 40 miles up, an unusual 5 times higher than the Earth's what we are produced out of. They are not created out of the water, and they may not have a different body made of sulfuric acid. Everywhere you go, they are working on trying to eat you away. As you go farther, things heat up. The thickening air allows the sun's heat in, but not out. It is also becoming dense. So compact, your probe drops like a coin in one. As we fell, we would gradually surface, constantly appearing to us as if we were nearing the bottom of the sea. Congratulations, you have landed on the warmest part in the solar system here. The official warmth is 870 degrees Fahrenheit. Day or night, equator or pole, the scoring heat never alters more than a few points, and it is why we possess so few pictures from the Venusian surface. So why is it so challenging to bring scientific devices to the surface of Venus? What about an average camera? There's plenty of daylight there. Why not simply send a camera and take photographs? I have got my NASA-issued spacesuit here, my personal Venus suit. Furthermore, let us take this camera and give it to Venus and perceive what issues. Primarily, you do not aspire to meet. It is such a tropical climate that all electronics, power, and communications must be solid. That is about anything automatic. Anything electronic is just an immense challenge to have a functioning covering. I think it would be rather like what might conceive of as how, you know, we would see heat waves and challenges in the atmosphere. If this was Venus, what would be changed? Well, we would not be here because we molt in small puddles of human beings. Furthermore, it is not the only energy you must bear. All that air above is heavy, squeezing at around 90 times the force on Earth. When I was a graduate student, I discussed what would get you first, the temperature or the stress. It would be pretty contemporary, I think. To penetrate to the surface of Venus is the same as diving over half a mile under sea. Tremendous pressure, enormous crushing force. How do you make something that withstands how things turn and move beneath? Those are valuable outside pressures. The automotive technology is all about exosuit, using composite fiber and durable aluminum alloys and stainless steel, titanium and all those things. It resembles something out of Transformers, or left out of a comic book. That's the identical suit that would require you to be on the exterior of Venus. You would never suspect the threats on the ground from orbit, except maybe for this extensive double-barreled storm hovering beyond these poles. We call dipole characteristics twirling around. We do not really understand what they are, but the complete feature itself, indeed 1,000 or 2 kilometers across, is not significant. It has a form, a type of expression to it. Believed to be formed by winds that roar throughout the equator at rates of 230 miles per hour, these typhoons can divide into 3, and indeed 4. Furthermore, the turbulent weather does not finish because the warmest planet in the solar system even has snow, but not as we know it. Suddenly, in the radar images, all the hills go white. Now that is because there is no profoundly reflective coating. It would not resemble white to your eyes if you could settle on the surface of Venus. Instead, it might seem shiny because we believe it might be some metallic film, almost like a pirate or a fool's gold. So something sparkly, which to me is even more helpful than staring at the snow. these are simply some problems that the European Space Agency's Venus Express, presently in orbit, wishes to solve. As we know how carbon dioxide dominates our climate, there has never more been a more suitable time to receive lessons from our neighbors. We are working to solve this excellent atmosphere, overly complex weather patterns, but with the latest data from Venus Express, we are studying by mapping out in three dimensions how the environment behaves. Unprotected by a magnetic shield, Venus is still being stripped of valuable water. Venus Express has seen how the solar wind erodes in the atmosphere. You can observe that, even now, that water is still emerging as oxygen and hydrogen. Furthermore, that is an implication that there has been more jumpiness in the past. Despite all this practical application, we still do not comprehend what triggered Venus's diabolical conversion. People argue over whether Venus ever had a satellite. If Venus had a moon at one point, could that moon have ultimately affected the surface, caused some accident to occur? We do not know. It could have probably held a constituent. Perhaps such an impression explains both the unfamiliar calendar and weather on Venus. Was it hit solid enough to flip upside down, and for its time to be slowed to a crawl? Was this the second Venus's climate was thrust into chaos? Whatever the condition of Venus's climate catastrophe, could life have ever endured such an ordeal? If I had to guess or had to bet, I would say, yeah. The Institute of Life, and I would say that because we know about life on Earth, is that it began early and did not appear to have required any unusual conditions. If there was a growth of our kind, the organic kind, on the exterior of Venus a long time ago, then what transpired to that life? One possibility is that it simply died out. But there is another event that is a little more exotic, which may have transferred up into the clouds. Some think Venus might still harbor life, even though it is such an unfriendly place. Moreover, the thought is that, well, gee, at one time, Venus was like the Earth in the opening 2 billion years of its history. So if consciousness were to grab a hold, perhaps life could linger ahead of the environmental catastrophe that befell Venus as the water abandoned the planet. Could life survive in the clouds of Venus? The most reliable method to know for sure is to drift into the atmosphere and discover why. Behind us is the Vala balloon, which we expect to fly in the atmosphere of Venus a few years from now. Vala will undertake acid clouds of Venus with a bit of guidance from frying pan technology. There have been two other balloons previously launched. Venus in the mid-1980s. These were the Vega embassies. There were a couple of separate balloons that the Russians placed into the environment. They appreciated doing the one thing to put Teflon on that whole balloon, and the balloon served perfectly for 2 days, simply as designed. Thus, we comprehend how Teflon works. Battling strong updrafts and acid vapors, these non-stick pioneers were cleared nearly halfway around the planet. Kevin demands Valor to go further. We will circumnavigate the planet that is floating around the world of Venus, not only once, just up to 5 times. Furthermore, if we do that, if we achieve that, we will significantly possess the world's record. It is the universal record for flying in the skies of any planet wherever. Underexploited, a remarkably alien, the tropical zone planets are ultimately identified as prime space travel objectives. Mercury, a planet that's both freezer and boiler. As a geologist, if I could lead back one rock, one specimen, I mean, that would improve our knowledge of Mercury by, you know, tenfold or something. So I desire to go to those polar craters and figure out what it is. Even if it's not liquid, it is something quite unusual and engaging. Moreover, Venus, our troubled counterpart, would like to explore the reasons that have not been explored before, so that I would pick Alpha Regio here. That is presumably the first spot I would go. I would love to see those snow-filled hilltops with silvery snow and see if we can sense what is going on there. Maybe some new games could be designed sliding downhill through these metallic snows. And then, of course, there is the ultimate story and what will occur to Earth in the far-off future which is another cause why we are involved in Venus, because Earth's terminal fate looks like Venus looks today. Venus and Mercury, two planets of surprise, but caught in their alien hells. Possibly not apparent goals to learn more about our home planet, but that is the value of traveling the solar system. It is just bursting with wonders.